Hello, my name is Christian Gollwitzer. I am from PTB, which stands for Physikalisch-Technische Bundesanstalt. The PTB is the National Metrology Institute of Germany. Our task is to realize the basic SI units, like the kilogram and the meter, but also to perform and develop traceable measurements of all kinds. The head office of PTB is in Braunschweig, and it has branches in Berlin-Charlottenburg and Berlin-Adlershof. In Berlin-Adlershof, the PTB operates multiple beamlines at the synchrotron radiation facility BESI 2. At one of these beamlines, the 4-crystal monochromator beamline, the PTB can, together with the HZB SACS setup, perform SACS measurements in a photon energy range from 1.75 kV to 10 kV. On this slide, you can see the principle of a SACS measurement. First, the sample is filled into a glass capillary, and then it's irradiated by the X-ray beam from the synchrotron. Most of the synchrotron light is directly transmitted through the sample or absorbed in the sample, but also a tiny fraction of radiation is scattered under small angles. The scattered radiation is then collected onto a two-dimensional detector. On the left side, you see the scattering pattern that was collected from the NP size 14 material. This is a dispersion of 50 nanometer silica particles in water. The scattering pattern is circularly symmetric. And after we collect the pattern, we average it over concentric circles to end up with a scattering curve, which you see on the right. The scattering curve displays the intensity of the scattered radiation as a function of Q, which is the magnitude of the scattering vector, and it is proportional to the sine of the scattering angle. In order to determine the diameter of nanoparticles from the scattering curve, we then fit a model to the experimental data. And from this model fit, we get the mean diameter of the particles, in this case 49.7 nanometers. Now the question remains, how accurate is this value? What is the uncertainty of this diameter? To answer this question, we need to make the measurement traceable. Traceability means that the result of a measurement relates directly to an SI unit via an unbroken chain of comparisons, each having a stated uncertainty. In the case of the diameter measurement via SACS, this SI unit is the meter. In practice, we achieve this via a so-called uncertainty budget. At the bottom, you can see such an uncertainty budget. Each row of the uncertainty budget corresponds to an input quantity which is required to compute the final value of the diameter, which is shown as the last row. For each of these input quantities, we determine the value, the uncertainty of the quantity, and how much it influences the final value, the so-called uncertainty contribution. In the end, we combine all of these uncertainty contributions into the total uncertainty of the diameter. Now, in order to get a traceable size determination by SACS, we first need a traceable Q-axis of our scattering curve. In the formula for Q, there are three input quantities, namely the photon energy, the pixel size of the detector, and the distance between sample and detector. The photon energy is known to a relative uncertainty of 10 to the minus 4. This has been measured by Bragg reflection of the synchrotron beam in a silicon single crystal, and therefore the photon energy is traceable to the lattice constant of silicon. The pixel size of the detector has also been previously measured by displacing the detector and measuring the shift of the scattering pattern on the detector. By this method, we get the pixel size of the detector with a relative uncertainty of 10 to the minus 3. Finally, the distance between sample and detector must be determined for each measurement individually. For this, we have optical encoders which measure very accurately the position of the detector. But this optical measurement system gives us only a relative displacement of the detector. In order to get an absolute position, we use a standard sample. On the left-hand side, you see the scattering pattern of a standard sample, which has a very pronounced ring. We then move the detector closer to the sample. Therefore, the ring shrinks, changes its size. And when we measure the radius of the ring and the displacement of the detector, we can compute the absolute position. On the right-hand side, you see the radius of this ring versus the position of the detector. And by fitting a straight line through these positions and extrapolating to the position where the radius would be zero, we get the total distance between detector and sample, with an uncertainty less than 1 millimeter, which is a relative uncertainty of 5 times 10 to the minus 4. Now we have a traceable q-axis, but how does this relate to the particle radius? The two, the q and the particle radius, are related by the model which we fit to the scattering curve. The problem is that these models are usually incomplete and idealized. For example, the particles are not perfectly spherical, they may not have a perfect constant density, there can be some background in the scattering. And therefore, we need to determine how the uncertainty of the q-axis propagates to the particle radius. This is done by fitting the experimental data with different fixed radii. So we not only fit it with the perfect radius, with the best fitting radius, but also with different radii, and check the goodness of fit parameter chi-square. On the right-hand side, you see a plot of chi-square versus the particle radius. As you can see, there is a parabolic-like shape, and at some point, this chi-square exceeds the value of 2. These are the two intersections between the red line and the chi-square. At this position, we know that the radius is by 1 standard deviation of the perfect radius. This gives us the relative uncertainty of the fit, which is typically of the order of a few percent. In the end, we get the uncertainty budget that was already shown in the first slide. We have determined the uncertainty of photon energy, pixel size and distance. From the fitting procedure, we get uncertainties for the beam position, the background and the diameter, and these all add up to an uncertainty in this case of 1.2 nanometers, which means that we have achieved traceability for NP-size 14 with a relative uncertainty of 2.4%. In NP-size, we have not only spherical particles, but also nanoparticles with different forms. For example, the NP-size 3 material is a dispersion of small bipyramids made of titania in water. And the NP-size 4 material is a dispersion of nanometric gold cubes. It is obvious that for these particles, we cannot model them as spheres. Here you see the experimental data, the scattering curve from the gold cubes. The blue line shows how a spherical model would fit to the data. As you can see, the maxima of the sphere do not fit to the measured features of the experimental data. So in NP-size, we developed a new software that allows us to fit arbitrarily shaped particles. The red curve is a simulation of a rounded cube model. That is a cube with rounded corners, fitted to the experimental data. With this software, we are also able to evaluate the scattering curve from the arbitrary shapes. So far, we have achieved a traceable Q-scale, and that gave us a traceable size determination of the nanoparticles. We can also make the intensity scale of the scattering curve traceable, and this will give us a traceable concentration measurements. This means we have to put the intensity scale on an absolute units. Absolute units in this context is the scattering cross section per volume. This is then an intrinsic material property. In the equation on top, you can see how the measured intensity, which is the scattered photon flux per solid angle, relates to the number concentration via a number of factors. Some of these factors are natural constants, others are known or can easily be measured, but there are also two of them which can only be determined with large uncertainties. These are the sample thickness and the electron density contrast. The sample thickness is the optical path of the X-ray beam through the sample, the length of the optical path. Usually, we measure in round capillaries, and there the optical path is not constant across the beam for the whole width of the beam. If we want to determine absolute units, we therefore use rectangular capillaries where the sample thickness is constant over the whole beam. But still, we need to measure the sample thickness for each individual measurement because these capillaries are not all the same. There has been some success by using micro-CT to measure the optical path of such a capillary. Of course, micro-CT is a lot of effort and we cannot do this for every single measurement. Instead, we use the absorption of a known calibration fluid, fluorinert, which is known to not mix with water. Then we fill the capillary half and half with fluorinert and the sample under test, and we can determine the optical path via the attenuation of the fluorinert. This allows us to measure the sample thickness with an uncertainty of a few percent. Now, the electron density contrast can be calculated for each material, but it is a material property of the nanoparticles. For example, for gold, we know the number of electrons, we know the atomic weight and the density, and from that we can compute the number of electrons per volume. This has to be done for each material individually, and we need to know the density of the particles. On the right hand side, you can see a comparison where the concentration has been measured using this method with other methods. In the end, a traceable concentration determination is possible if the chemical composition and the particle density is known. In summary, traceable measurement methods allow us to provide values with realistic uncertainties. This tells us not only the value of a measurement, but also how accurate the measurement is. SACS can be used as a traceable method for size determination of nanoparticles, if these nanoparticles are suitable. In NPSize, we have also developed software which allows us to measure non-spherical particles. And we can also use SACS to perform a traceable concentration measurement on some samples. Thanks for watching.